She was the most seductive, sexual image of woman ever committed to celluloid. She's the only unrepentant hedonist, the only pure pleasure seeker I think I've ever known. When men bored her, she walked out on them. When Hollywood bored her, she walked out on Hollywood. She gave it up and went into retirement, from which she's never emerged.
September 1928, I'd been 3 years at Paramount in Hollywood, and I was terribly in love with George Marshall. He was a very rich, young laundryman, and he later became the owner of the famous Redskin football team. And he called me one day and he said, you know, in September, he said, you know, tomorrow your option comes up. He called me from Washington. I said, oh, really? He said, yes, Monte Bell, MGM, called me and told me all about it. And he said, now look, when you go in to see Schulberg, he's going to tell you that he will keep you on at $750 a week, but he won't give you the raise in your option. And he said, I also know that some guy in Berlin called Pabst wants you for a very famous picture, I hear. And he'll give you $1,000 a week. So you let Schulberg talk, and when he's finished, you say, thank you, Mr. Schulberg, but I'll quit and go to Germany. And that is what I did, much to Mr. Schulberg's surprise. And of course, later he put out the story that I left because my voice was bad and didn't record well.
Many years later, Louise Brooks wrote, at the Eden Hotel where I lived, the cafe bar was lined with the better-priced trollops. The economy girls walked the street outside. On the corner stood the girls in boots advertising flagellation. Actors' agents, pimps for the ladies in luxury apartments in the Bavarian Quarter. The nightclub El Dorado displayed an enticing line of homosexuals dressed as women. Collective Lust roared unashamed at the theater. In the review Chocolate Kiddies, when Josephine Baker appeared naked except for a girdle of bananas, it was precisely as Lulu's stage entrance was described. They rage there as in a menagerie when the meat appears at the cage. I revered Pubs for his truthful picture of this world of pleasure, which let me play Lulu naturally.
You see, they've been waiting me for a long time. He'd been looking all over Europe for a girl to play this part. And he was going to give it to Marlena Dietrich. She was too old, and the girl was...
And this is the early Dietrich.
Yeah, right? She was 5 years older than I was 20. She was 25, but don't forget, she'd been around for years in Berlin, when it was really rough.
What I meant by the early Dietrich, it was the...
The Blue Angel Dietrich, it was. But you know, she was very knowing and suave, and as he said, one looked and Lulu would be dead. But at any rate, it was very hard for him to find a truly beautiful woman in Europe. Did you know that in Europe? They weren't beautiful all over. And she came the closest. And he said, the very day I got the cable from you saying that you would come, she was sitting in my office and I was going to sign her. Pabst had never seen me. He'd seen me in one picture called A Girl in Every Port, Howard Hawks made at Fox. And of course, I'd never heard of him. We met on the platform of the station Am Zoo. And I don't know, it was just as if we'd known each other forever. And it was the most curious experience I've ever had in my life. He understood me absolutely perfectly, because that really was his genius.
Around 1898, the German avant-garde playwright Frank Wedekind created the mythic character Lulu, a beautiful, sexually attractive, yet innocent woman, constantly involved with an extraordinary array of people with disastrous results. The German director G.W. Pabst made a film version of Wedekind's play. He cast Louise Brooks, a 20-year-old beauty, a Ziegfeld girl, a fledgling film star, to play the part of Lulu.
The funny thing about Lulu was this. He knew instinctively that I was Lulu, and that was fine in the picture. Mm-hmm. Making the movie was perfect. He just turned me loose and I'd be all right. But off the set, he wanted me to be an intelligent woman, a well-disciplined actress, and I wasn't. He was taking drinks out of my hand, seeing that I was kept in my room, and he was furious because he approached people intellectually. And you couldn't approach me intellectually because there was nothing to approach. So he was always a little bit mad at me.
At the same time, he was aware that you were a Lulu.
Oh, absolutely. But he didn't like it. And the second thing was this terrible shock when he saw George Marshall, this tall, handsome guy with a drunken
English. Oh, he came with you?
Of course, that's why we went, because George didn't care about the film. He wanted to go to Europe for fun. And Pabst looked around. Of course, George was a huge, big, handsome, black-haired man with a drunken English valet. And don't forget, George was from West Virginia, and he talked rather like that. And the valet staggering around with huge amounts of luggage, and Pabst said, and George explained who he was, and immediately took charge of everything. But Pabst was perfectly furious. And, of course, that was only the beginning, because every time we met, I always had a guy, and a different guy, and it was a long series over the years of his getting madder and madder. Marshall would take us. Marshall had a gift for finding. We'd go to Horses, marvelous restaurant, and always in tails, and I don't think Pabst liked to get in tails, and I don't think Trudy had many evening dresses. And we had this wild week. I had to be on the set every morning, hot or cold, whether he used me or not, at 9 o'clock, and George would have me up all night, and Pabst was furious, and we'd all go to dinner, and Trudy would glare at me and refuse to speak English. And Pabst was furious with George, and George didn't give a damn. He spent a week there. He had Phillips, my manager. He had appointed my manager, whom I gave $100 a week. He told me how to pay each person. And Phillips, of course, took him to all the most expensive brothels. And he had absolutely a marvelous time. And he would take me to the theater every night, and I'd come on the set with clear eyes. And so Pabst was furious. He didn't ask when he was leaving. But suddenly one morning, I remember we were shooting the murder scene. And
where you murdered Dr. Sean?
Yeah, and Courtney was wandering around testing chocolate syrup to see whether it was sweet enough. You know, he'd had to sponge it up. And George came on the set in disarray. He said to Pabst, you'll be...